Thank you all for joining us today for our event. My name's Anita and I lead the public programme here at DAX. Welcome to Voices from the Factory. This is the second event in our series Artist Spaces, which asks the question, how do the spaces where artists make work impact their creative practice and the wider artistic community? For those of you less familiar with our work, DAX is a membership organisation established by artists for artists almost 40 years ago, with a mission to transform the financial landscape for visual artists and artist estates in the UK. Through our public programme, we invite leading artists and curators and thinkers to join us in conversation, providing a platform for our community to interrogate the leading issues that are facing artists working today. So tonight, we're exploring the legacy of perhaps the most famous of artist studios, Andy Warhol's factory, which was endlessly documented through Warhol's lens and those of his collaborators. Stories from the factory have become the stuff of legends, but what is the legacy of this radical and pioneering space? Joining us to help answer this and many other questions tonight, and to chair our panel is Jean Wainwright. Jean is an art historian, a writer, curator, and a leading Warhol scholar, she's based here in London. As a writer and academic, she's been published extensively and speaks internationally on Warhol's legacy. Jean has also amassed an incredible archive of artist interviews, which she has also very generously given us access to this evening. So we'll be hearing some extracts of interviews that she's conducted with voices from those who experienced the factory firsthand today, which is a real treat. So thank you very much, Jean. Before I hand over to Jean and to our panel, there's some housekeeping. There will be some time reserved for questions from the audience tonight. That'll be towards the end of the event. So please do submit your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. You can do that at any point during the conversation. They'll all be picked up by the panel, and closed captioning is also available for the event. So you can access that tool by clicking the icon at the bottom of your screen. So nothing more from me. I'll hand over to Jean to kick things off.
Jean? Okay, so if Eric, Kiara and Pandemonia, if you could send on your pictures. Right, so first of all, I introduce Eric Shiner, who was recently the executive director of Pioneer Works in Brooklyn. He was formerly artistic director of White Cube New York and senior vice president of contemporary art at Sotheby's. But prior to this, where I met him, he was the director of the Andy Warhol Museum in Pittsburgh from 2010 to 2016 and was Milton Fine Curator of Art at the Warhol from 2008 to 2010. He's a leading scholar on Andy Warhol and Asian contemporary art, and he's curated dozens of contemporary art exhibitions in cities around the globe. My second guest is Pandemonia, and Pandemonia is a multimedia conceptual art project centered around a female motif constructed from symbols and archetypes, and she was born around 2000. Through public interventions, she's absorbed by the media complex, appearing in print magazines, film, social media, public product, major product advertisements, to reach and affect public consciousness. In addition, she uses her celebrity of life as a narrative, to create a wide range of art and products reflecting and commenting on 21st century life. She says, I created Pandemonium from mass media imagery, then fed her back into the same media. She is, she says, like a modern day Trojan horse. And my third guest is Kiara Clemente, who grew up between Italy, India, and New York, and her love of capturing people can be traced back to childhood spent in her father Francesco Clemente's studio, watching him paint portraits. Her career has spanned more than a decade as a director and producer in the realm of documentary, short films, branded content, and commercials, and she's gained a reputation for depicting intimate and revealing moments with people of many backgrounds. Her passion for the conversation has become integral to her filmmaking style. And in 2016, she created and directed the short film Screen Stories, and that was inspired by letters to Andy Warhol and was part of a worldwide traveling exhibition. She's currently working on a new documentary with the artist and fashion duo Isabel and Ruben Toledo. Now, what I'm going to introduce next is four voices from Warhol's factory. It was difficult to know who to choose. So the first one is Nat Finkelstein, took place in London in 2000, and it talks about him going to a party at the Silver Factory, and which came into existence at Warhol Space in 1963. He was a photographer for 3 years at the factory from 1964. And his widow recalls a story about Jean Krasner taking Nat to the factory. She recalls this from this actual interview clip I sent her. And she said, he came from the Tom Wolfe book party, no less. And secondly, I'm playing John Warhol, Andy Warhol's brother, and he's just talking a little bit about growing up with his brother, Andy, and that was from 2001. Now, it was took place in the Warhol Museum. The sound's a bit difficult, but I feel quite integral to Warhol's taping aesthetic. And the third is Billy Nane, responsible for silvering Warhol's factory, so that iconic Silver Factory space. And he's a filmmaker, and he was a filmmaker, photographer, and lighting director, a very important figure at the factory from 63 and 1970, and finally to 1970. And finally, we have Bridget Berlin, who was one of Warhol's superstars and arguably one of Warhol's greatest talkers. And she is talking about when Warhol died, and she goes, she comes from England. She was at a health farm in England. She flies back to New York. So without further ado, I'll play these recordings.
Very pretty young lady sitting there, and she looked at me and I looked at her, and it was the 60s. So I wandered over and I said, what are you thinking about? And she said, sex. And I said, well, that's funny. That's about the same thing I'm thinking about. Where do you want to do it? And she said, well, why don't we get out of here and go down to Andy Warhol's factory? We went down to the factory, and it was the 100th famous people's party that was going on. There was a space on the couch. We jumped on the couch, and one thing led to the other, and we had sex on the couch. When we were finished and she was putting her clothing back on, she went to get her makeup, and she discovered that someone had stolen her purse. I said to myself, the music is great. The scene is absolutely insane. If ever anyone wanted to draw a picture of decadence in America, this is it. And I think the art is phenomenal.
What Andy really was fascinated by was movie stars. You know, it was hard to get like 10 cents to go to the movie. So it was really a treat. He was so fascinated with going to a movie, and he looked up to movie stars, and he would write to them when he was probably 9 or 10 years old. He wrote to Shirley Temple, and she sent him a photo of her. She signed it all to Andy Warhol.
Did he show that to you?
Yeah, my mother was real easygoing, and she's the one that really encouraged him in drawing. I mean, ever since he was small, all of us had to, like in the wintertime, the three boys would sit at the kitchen table, around the kitchen table. And she'd say, the one that makes the nicest drawing will get a prize, you know. Andy would always seem to win. It was a chocolate bar.
I started working with Andy in New York in 1963. It was the year he had decided he was going to resign from being a painter. So he went to Paris, and in a very Duchampian way, you know, announced he was resigning from painter and going to become a filmmaker. So he sort of felt he had culminated and succeeded in his art in recognition as a fine arts painter, and now was going to duplicate what he had done in painting in film, bring film to a form of fine arts that the masses could see as art films. So he bought a Bolex 16 millimeter camera and handed me the Pentax 35 millimeter SLR he had been using for still photography. Said, Billy, you do the still photography, I'm going to start making films.
And I arrived in New York and went right from Kennedy Airport to the factory. And I walked in, there were all these flowers on the table when I walked in. And it was really, really, really hard. And then Paige Powell called me up that evening, and I almost freaked out. She said, I love Dandy so much. All I wanted was to have his baby. Well, I burst out laughing to the point of no return, but it might have sounded like crying. It was so crazy.
Thank you. So now I'm going to go into the first question. So Eric, I'd like to ask you, when did you first become aware of Andy Warhol and in what capacity?
Well, Jean, thank you for having me first off. And that is a very good foundational question. As a young kid in Western Pennsylvania, an hour north of Pittsburgh, where of course Andy hails from, I grew up on a horse farm and of course realized pretty quickly that I was much more of an urban sort than a country sort of boy. And my very first interaction with Andy Warhol was on MTV, of all places, because Andy was fairly frequently featured on MTV and of course produced a video for the Cars and was very much a part of the zeitgeist of New York City in the 1980s. So it was a combination of MTV and of course Interview Magazine, which in so many ways was a lifeline to the hip, cool side of America at that time. And that's how I first fell in love with all things Warhol and all things New York.
Oh, thank you. Well, Pandemonia, what about you? How were you first aware of Andy Warhol?
Well, I sort of kind of been aware in stages. I think first of all with Andy Warhol, I think it was like sort of Christmas cards or going rummaging for the old Christmas card box. So these like pictures of Marilyn Monroe, and they really, you know, stuck in my mind as a child, and didn't say I really understood it, or no one seemed to be able to explain it to me, but I think that's where I first became aware. And then later on, you know, as a teenager, you know, sort of going to art college, pop art, and then music as well, the sort of Velvet Underground and the whole Lou Reed legacy thing. But then as I sort of started making more art myself, sort of various Andy Warhol ideas keep sort of feeding back into what I was doing, kind of inadvertently.
Thank you. That was a great answer. There's so much you could pick up already. And Chiara, what about you? What about how you first became?
For me, at first, I wasn't so aware, although, you know, my parents came to New York in the early 80s and I with them from Italy, and there quickly became part of this wonderful artist circle, which Andy was part of. But I was young enough not to be aware of who the artists were. I was just able to absorb a lot of them coming through the studio. I think my first really powerful memory where I remember Andy and kind of the idea of him was at Odeon, where a lot of the artist community would go on Sundays for brunch. And I still to this day can remember someone coming in, saying something to my father, him looking really, you know, shocked and kind of going out through the revolving doors. And that was the day that Andy passed away. So that is actually probably in my, you know, memory, the first moment that I really recognized, you know, Andy and who he was. And then obviously as I became a filmmaker, then was able to go back and really look at his work. And that was, you know, how it started.
Oh, well, great. It's three very different aspects of Warhol as well. So fantastic. Eric, I wanted to ask you, you went to work as the director of the Warhol Museum in 2010. How important is his legacy as an artist?
The import of his legacy is really unrivaled in so many ways in terms of contemporary art. I think the only other artist that comes as close to Warhol is his own hero, Marcel Duchamp. And of course, Duchamp opened the door to what could be considered art, whereas Warhol blew the door off the hinges and made it really a completely open territory so that artists could make anything and label it art. He thus truly democratized art in so many ways, but his legacy is found every day, and contemporary artists working in the here and now have to somehow factor their practice, their work into a Warholian vocabulary, whether they are paying homage to Warhol or critiquing Warhol. In so many ways, he remains the bellwether of contemporary art production today, love him or hate him.
That's a great answer. Well, also, I wanted to ask you, Eric, because we're talking about factory spaces or spaces, artist spaces, what was it that made Warhol's factory, especially the Silver Factory, which most people remember more, I think, so important as a working environment?
Yeah. There are just so many factors. It is though all of the ingredients for a really wonderful baked Alaska flambé were all put into place at the same time. And that included everything from him and his phenomenal art production and his process of making through to his social circles, through to his varied interests in so many different spheres of cultural production, whether it be the visual arts, opera, ballet, the performing arts writ large, and certainly film. And he was, as his brother John so rightly noted, a complete lover and aficionado of Hollywood cinema and the concept of fame. But I think the single most important thing that made the factory the very hip and cool environment was that it was, is that Andy knew how to bring people together from all segments of society, whether high or low, and bring them together into one space. So you would often find yourself at the factory sitting next to a high society art patron or a down and out musician who might have later gone on to become someone as famous as Bob Dylan. And it really was this mixture of all sorts of people in a space of creativity, and of course, a space that mimicked the future, because when Billy silvered the factory, he saw it not only as an indication of the future, space travel, the new, what's to come, but he also was referencing the past of the Hollywood silver screen. So
I'm going to have to stop you, Eric. It's brilliant. Yeah,
I've got it's just this perfect mix of cool.
Thank you. I felt awful interrupting you, but I've got lots of questions and I'm trying
right
to
ahead.
Everybody in. Kiara, we're going to show you, and it relates brilliantly to what you've just said, Eric, so that's great. We're going to see the opening to your film Screen Stories now. This is part of a longer film that was in partnership with the Andy Warhol Museum, and I think it actually really points to some of the things that Eric's just said, so it very neatly fits in.
To labour with me during the Nutcracker Suite in a theatre and stayed throughout the performance. So technically I was born in a theatre.
I think the first thing I wanted to be when I was a child was a magician. And then probably an astronaut.
I was always dressing up my little brothers in sort of a house coat with tinsel stapled around the edge to be like a royal cape and making them perform, you know, little plays I'd written, like a total dictator.
I imagine I would be a taxi driver when I grow up. I thought to be stuck in a very formal relation with different kinds of people would be fun.
I wanted to be a song and dance man. I wanted to be in a top hat and tails, some hybrid between a Fred Astaire and a Gene Kelly.
First thing I asked my brother when I was really little was, I want to be a rabbit. He said, you can't be a rabbit. I thought you'd grow up being anything you wanted.
Thank you so much. Kiara, you refer to these films as portraits, obviously. So perhaps you could explain a little bit more about them and the links to Warhol, because there are lots of links I can see, but just maybe if you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I always say that, you know, when I make films, it's really giving voices to subjects and bringing them out. And I think when I was making this film per se, which is very, you know, more directly actually to Warhol, I had the chance to go back and look at a screen test and to really watch them. And if you look at them, what's extraordinary about them is that people are looking into camera, not saying a word, but you get so much out of them because of who's behind the camera, because Andy being there, or even if he wasn't, just the presence of him, you know, being there and capturing, it's like you're getting so much in the first seconds. And I, interesting enough, at the beginning where you see part of that film, I did my own version of them. And it was amazing to see, because at first, you know, people are posing, but then they're just being drawn out. And it's really about who's behind the camera. And that also in my work, I find that the conversation, the connection I make with my subject is just as integral as a visual story I try to tell. And so in that sense, I think Andy and I really connected, and I was able to really see it, especially, you know, very literally in the screen test he did.
Yeah, and I also just wanted to ask you about the significance of New York City. You obviously made a film, Our City Dreams, which won awards, and Warhol also documented his factory spaces and used the city as a site. So what is the significance for you about place when making your works?
Well, I think for me, I mean, with Our City Dreams, and I think it does tie in some ways to Warhol, is that I came back to New York after 8 years of being away. I left as a child. I came back, you know, in my mid-20s and ready to make a film, you know, ready to re-enter the city. But it was intimidating because, you know, when you leave in one way and come back in another, and New York can be that way. So I was able to really rediscover both the city and myself through the lens. And I think in that way, what's amazing about Andy does with his film is he explores his subjects, and obviously New York City during that time is really seen through the subjects that he picks, and his, be it his friends or people that he cast. But I think location does, the energy, I mean, the energy of New York remains, you know, although it's changed so many ways and so many times, it continues. And, you know, I try to find other places to go. And obviously I film all over the world, but New York, yet again, as I do this feature I'm working on, I'm back, you know, celebrating two creative figures that, you know, really came out of this place. So I think it seems obvious that being this cauldron of creatives and energy that Andy would do that. And I continue in my own way.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm sure all the panelists, I can feel us all kind of wanting to jump in the whole time because there's so much coming out already. But Pandemonia, if you could come back on screen now. You created your alter ego. We're now going to see a selection of your work, and then I'm going to ask you a couple of questions about it. You've got a little compilation to play now. Obviously, you've created an iconic Pandemonium. Warhol created his alter ego. So can you talk a little bit about that conception, your conception of you sitting here, really?
Well, I wanted to make some work about sort of contemporary culture. And originally, I was an abstract artist, but I was very interested in things like semiotics and advertising language. And then in the 2000s, I saw this thing happen. Well, this celebrity culture went crazy in London, and all the celebrities were on the newspaper on the front cover, and we all had smartphones that were all pointing at us, and Facebook and Instagram appeared. And I thought, this is a really good opportunity to sort of to create my own celebrity out of like symbols and try and place it in that celebrity slot in the newspaper. So that was the sort of the genesis. And it was like a sort of a situationist performance where I'd break myself out of these advertising ideals and then sort of feed it back into the media, into the newspapers, and also do adverts as well for people as well. So it really became very circular and ironic, and that's where she came from.
Thank you very much, Eric. I wanted to ask you, Warhol was great at publicizing himself, often by staying silent and letting others speak for him. But what's the importance of all these different media, because this was following on from obviously what Pandemonia was saying, you know, all these different media that she uses and all the different media that Warhol uses. So what's the importance of that, do you think? And also him kind of staying silent in a way, not speaking.
It is so linked to his early decade of his career in New York City in the advertising industry, where Andy was really the most prominent illustrator in the business, winning every award known to mankind. So he was thus illustrating commercialism in New York and by extension America in the 1950s, whether it was his I. Miller shoe drawings through to Christmas cards done for Tiffany and many other fashion magazines, department stores, etc. So he silently was putting imagery out into the world and letting people respond, usually through buying something. So it makes sense that he returns to that very subject for his first pop art painting, starting, of course, with the comic book illustration images first, then Coca-Cola, and ultimately Campbell's Soup, which, of course, propels him to fame. But it's very important to remember always that Andy was a true innovator. He was experimenting constantly in new media, whether that be the use of the very first Norelco video camera in making his first video piece, Inner and Outer Space, which is really done almost at the same time as Nam June Paik making his first video artworks, and keep going. So he's constantly recording with a tape recorder. He's making films. He's thinking about how you document your life through mass media and how you put it out to the world thus. So it's just part and parcel of his process. And when we now look back at Warhol, we can easily say that he was really the beta version of what we know as reality television now through his film Chelsea Girls, through to a beta version of Facebook through his celebrity commissioned portraits ad nauseum.
Well, that's great, because I think we're ready to load the film again, which is great because it leads very neatly into what Pandemonia's works talks to.
Do you ever feel like you are living in a bubble, adrift and floating in space? Unable to extricate oneself, one searches for entrances and exits. Turning and turning, the bubble seamlessly rearranges itself and envelops all.
Well, there was a little bit of buffering there, I'm sorry, but okay, Pandemonia, Warhol, obviously, and Eric's introduced that very well, uses the tools of mass media, but you use social media in a very particular way. You know, you've kind of taken further what Warhol was doing. So can we talk a little bit about that in your work?
Well, Warhol was in the analog age, and I mean, originally I was a printmaker, which was an analog thing. And as soon as digital media came along, I went out of my way to learn the tools because I could see that this was the way to make art for the future, use the future tools. And I liked social media because it's like a kind of a conversation with the audience. It's about the what you put out there and the audience reaction. And that's the same in all artwork, really. There's a sort of the object-subject thing going on.
You also work in lots of different media, as you say, with printmaking. We saw a little bit of that there as well. So using all these different tools from different social situations, etc.
Well, I mean, I saw Panda, when I created Pandemonia, she's like an idea, she's like the idea of a thing. So, you know, I have my little dog. It's not a real dog, it's an idea of the dog. And once you're an idea, you can move across different mediums, just like celebrities do. And that's something I noticed a long time ago, that, you know, you go to all these art gallery openings and everybody's concentrated on the center of the room, on the social scene, not the actual artwork. And celebrities can be on radio, television, newspapers. And so as an idea, I wanted my artwork to be able to like cross all these different boundaries. And so it kind of worked very well with social media.
Yeah, I mean, you've raised so many questions about being in the inside, the outside, the bubble, identity, you know, Warhol hiding behind something. Gosh, we could just have a whole talk on that. But yeah. I want to just, and probably we will at the end, hopefully there'll be lots of questions. Chiara, I wanted to ask you though, because your work also as a filmmaker concentrates on identity, and you've got some exceptional interviews from people. And I wonder where that's come from, that, you know, observing people.
Well, I think it started really early subconsciously, because as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, in the 80s, when we moved to New York City, my parents' studio, we lived where my father worked, and artists came through all the time, especially because my mother was an amazing cook. So they would also come and gather and eat and chat. And I just remember it wasn't, you know, divided. It wasn't the kids over there and the, you know, parents over there. It was, we were all kind of part of it. And I just remember listening and hearing and the characters that came through. And again, I was very young, so not aware of who anyone was, which I think in a way was better, because they were just these great figures, you know, some scary, but some really interesting. You know, there was all sorts of people. But it was just the listening. I think why my films then really come through and why I'm able to get things out of people is that I think I'm a good listener, you know, and even in that conversation in the filming, it's, I'm really curious about getting to the bottom of things and really opening people up and letting them kind of speak about themselves. And so I think those early formative years really, you know, played a part in that and continue to this day. I mean, I became a filmmaker because I wanted to tell stories visually. That was my goal. But then, you know, as it grew and grew, like, even when I'm not doing films, I feel like I get so much out of just listening to people and their stories and imagining it and then bringing it to life on film. So it really evolved. But I think it really started then.
Well, I've got it's not really a final question because I've got a couple more questions, but it's really for everybody, each of you to answer. Starting with Pandemonia, 15 minutes of fame. It's one of Warhol's most famous quotes. And, you know, what is fame? How relevant is that quote today? You know, it's endlessly quoted, but what does it actually mean in today's terms?
I don't know anymore. I don't know. I mean, I think fame is a really interesting concept, because it's like, it's something that affects everybody, even if you're not interested in it. It's something that's inside you. You can't help but be connected to this fame thing. And that's very interesting. It's like language, it's like media, it's, you know, we are all interconnected, and that's just part of life.
You're absolutely right. And also, I think what you were just talking about, Chiara, and also what Eric was talking about, the factory space, these kind of different spaces and how people emerge from these different spaces. But I just wanted to ask you, Eric, because the 15 minutes of fame, you've probably seen that slogan or that statement so many times. What does it mean?
Just a few, but I think that it is now really, you know, 5 seconds of fame, if you're lucky, on social media, because it's that very quick acknowledgement of someone either performing on a TikTok video or on an Instagram picture. But I've always found the other side, the flip side of fame, to be just as interesting, which I guess we could call infamy in many ways. And also the fact that many people, once they achieve fame, want nothing to do with it and try to withdraw from it, to hide from the camera, and are often very unsuccessful in so doing. So fame is thus a machine, an operation that very little of us have any control over whatsoever.
That's a really good answer. And I'm sure we could talk a lot about that as well. And then Chiara, perhaps you could respond to Eric's question or respond to...
Well, no, I think what's interesting with that is, for me and a lot of the films I do, you know, they really celebrate artists and what goes into being an artist, or, you know, a chef, or I do all sorts of, you know, people. And for me, you know, fame is something that even before social media, people became very intrigued with. And I remember a moment where it shifted, I don't know exactly when, where you'd ask a child, what do you want to be? And they'd say famous. And there was not, I want to be this, I want to be that. It was just famous. Fame became this thing. So I think in my work, I really strive, and again, I think I've done it in different versions of this new film, really celebrates this in what it takes to not per se become famous, but become in a way an icon, or become, you know, to become a figure that people then look up to and respect. And so I would like to contradict in the idea of what it really takes to be perhaps the artist you admire, the musician you love, you know, and maybe, you know, nowadays, even some of the Instagram or social media people, there's some that, yes, are quick and there, but there's some that hopefully will keep going and it becomes a bigger thing. So I think in that way, I still celebrate the, you know, the integral and the work that goes into becoming who you want to be.
Well, a question has raised itself in my head as we've been talking. So I'm going to ask each of you this question. If you could choose a point in Warhol's life where you could meet him and go and hang out in one of the spaces, which would it, you know, which would it be? Which work would you like to see him making, you know, or which part of maybe when he was making work would you feel drawn to? Pandemonia, do you have any thoughts on that?
I think the still screen portraits, I think I'd love to have seen, you know, the process of how he did that.
Yeah, particularly as you kind of, the whole Marilyn has become such so legendary as well, some of those early portraits.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's very interesting. I mean, in my stuff, I sort of chose not to sort of do a, you know, look like Marilyn. So I always tried to keep myself my own sort of ideas. But I mean, I think a lot of the ideas, you know, there are parallels in Warhol. So that would have been a good point to.
And you did a see. Last Supper, of course, as well. You did a last, you did.
Yes, well, I'm interested in
the Last Supper.
Yeah, well, I'm very interested in icons and myths, and, you know, Marilyn is a myth. You know, and the same with, you know, if you go, well, we should, oh, here it is, yeah.
There we've got Pandemonia's Last Supper.
The same with Botticelli or with, you know, the Mona Lisa. These are kind of like icons that exist. You can zoom, if you've got a magnifying glass, you can zoom into it. There we are.
Oh, there we go. There you are.
It's extremely detailed.
Yeah.
These are all different versions of Pandemonia I created.
That you've actually performed as these different characters as well, haven't you?
Yeah. Yeah, I worked with a photographer, Pedro Matos, and we photographed it on a table in his kitchen. So it's just a small table. And then I took away all the pictures and I built them into this composition.
But I've met you as some of these Pandemonias.
Of course.
Which is really, I mean, really great.
Yeah, it's years and years of work, yeah. All these different versions.
And Chiara, I wanted to ask you then, what about you? Would there be any time or any particular work you might have liked to?
I mean, involved in? Yeah, the obvious answer would be over his shoulder as, or maybe in a corner of a room so he would not disturb as he was capturing people on film in various, you know, in various films. But I think more my curiosity is the archive that he created with all the things he kept, which now I know are, you know, are a big part of the Warhol Museum. And how he selected those and create these time shows, you know, and that for me, like what went into that is really where my curiosity lies and what it tells you about him. So I think that's really what I'd want to be there and ask him about.
Well, that's a great point. You believe the more things you created, the more you left out there, the more famous you would become after you were dead. What about you, Eric?
Well, you know, picking any particular period or work of art is akin for me to picking your favorite child. So
yeah, I
wouldn't pick a particular time frame. But what I would really love to have done more than anything is to have gone shopping with Andy one day on one of his strolls down Madison Avenue when he would pop into jewelry stores and antique shops and acquire, because Warhol, as we know, was a massive collector. He may be deemed a hoarder in today's lingo, but seeing what he was interested in terms of objects, I think would be very eye-opening to experience that at his side.
Yeah, all great answers, I must say, about, you know, his life. And it is very difficult to capture, certainly with three such fantastic speakers, to capture all the different aspects. But let's see what we've got. Some questions, and let's see what we've got here. We've got one from Caroline Mauer. Early on, innovation was raised. I'm confused as to how any of this is innovative in how women are portrayed. Oh, having casual sex, lots of makeup, amazing cooks. Okay, shall I might just answer that. I think what we were talking about, I think, was the Caroline, is really that this factory space was produced, and it was very decadent, and it was the 60s, so it was very different from what had gone before in the 1950s. So people did often feel very liberated going to that space. So I think that would be my answer. I don't think it was so much, it was really about being liberated from the constraints of the era before. I don't know whether I can bring in Eric or Chiara or Pandemonia maybe to comment on that from the aspects of their own work as well, perhaps.
Yeah. And you're absolutely correct. And also, it's very important to note that it was one of the very first safe spaces for the queer community, where drag queens, transgendered individuals, gay men and women were welcomed with open arms. Andy, of course, himself being gay. And that was critically important for that specific moment in time.
Chiara, did you have a comment on that as well?
I mean, I can speak to my work. I mean, I feel like, again, I don't know if I want to comment on, you know, as far as, yeah. I think I agree that it was, there was such a crossover of types of people and characters. And I think, as you mentioned, post-50s, that it was a very different time. But I mean, I think with my work and women, it's, you know, I celebrate women in all sorts of way, in all sorts of capacities. And I think it's my connection to being a woman itself that kind of ties to that, and that dialogue is natural. So I can speak to that.
And Pandemonia, because you've spoken a lot about feminism in your work and your practice as well.
Well, I think there's an irony about beauty. And when I was constructing Pandemonia, I was thinking of it as being a bit like Naomi Wolf talked about the Iron Maiden. So it's like, it appears beautiful, but it's not natural. And it's actually, performing Pandemonia is actually a very physically daunting thing to do. It's like, it's hard, it's very hard on the body. It may look sort of, you know, bouncy and shiny and stuff, but it's a harsh environment. And so in a way, by acting Pandemonia out, I'm sort of, you know, it's sort of pointing at some of these inconsistencies in popular culture.
Thank you. great answers there. That's another question. This is from Martha. She said, what are your opinions, panel, on the NFT artworks? Could they be a natural trajectory from Andy Warhol? I don't know whether, perhaps you could put your raise your hand, panelists, if you particularly could talk to that one. Getting many hands up there. I mean, I think my particular take on that would be that Warhol was into every innovation. I think that's been raised by the panel very eloquently. And so I think probably it's very difficult to predict. People say, oh, what, you know, how would he have used computers? He did use computers, but how would he use them now? Would he have used that? He may have dabbled with them, you know. I don't think one could answer that. Is it a natural progression? Difficult to say, really. All I can say is that he listened to people. And if people were talking about those kind of things, he probably would have picked up on it. So I don't know whether everyone agrees with that. And then another question. What do you think Warhol would have, what do you think Warhol would have made of social media or the digital space more broadly? So maybe we've touched on that a little bit, but what do we think maybe Warhol would have made of the digital space? Anybody want to answer that?
Well, I'll jump in quickly, but certainly, as you just noted, Andy did do works on the Amiga computer and did several different versions. The most widely known is the Portrait of Blondie that he performed live, which viewers can tune into YouTube and actually watch that being done. But he was also really interested in technology writ large. He had a hologram of himself made, for example. He was always thinking about what would come next. So yes, I do think he probably would have, if he were still alive, been dabbling in the NFT sphere, but he knew that technology shifted and that to stay relevant, he should likely shift with the times as well.
Yeah, and Pandemonium, I think you raised your hand there as well to make a comment.
I was going to agree, really. I'm sure Warhol would have jumped into using computers, and as he did do early stuff in the Amiga, and I'm sure he would do stuff with NFTs as well. But I would hope with his NFT work, he would have thought about it in a different way to us and maybe have made something more relevant with it, that may be more long-lasting.
Yeah, well, we don't seem to have so many more questions. So I wanted really to then, unless people, if you put your questions in the chat, the question and answer box. But otherwise, I had some, you know, more questions really relating to all the panel's works. I mean, Chiara, looking at your work, relating to the screen test, the way you set up the brick wall, you know, and it was so reminiscent of the silver factory wall and then the angles of the camera. So I wanted to draw you a little bit more out on that, perhaps, you know, how you researched to do something like that.
That was actually really fun because we actually filmed that all around the world. We filmed in London, we filmed in New York, we filmed in LA, but it needed to feel like they were all in one factory or one space. So it was great working, you know, I usually work with more natural kind of backgrounds and with locations, but with that we worked, you know, I worked with an art director and we created something that was a natural nod to the factory. So the silver brick wall. And even in the way we shot it and thinking it was going to be in black and white, there's the kind of like an old Hollywood look to how we shot everyone. And then I wish we could shot it on the Bolex, but we didn't, but we definitely referenced it, which is what, you know, and I do actually shoot, I've shot with RCD Dreams. I shot a lot on the Bolex 60 millimeters. So it's definitely a camera that I really connect to and just feel like it creates magic in its own way, whatever it captures. So yeah, it was a great, you know, it's interesting when you do, and I think I'd be, you know, curious to hear other artists work, but like, you know, as a filmmaker to reference some, you know, it was a reference, it was inspired really because it's part of this exhibition that was about Warhol's correspondence. And so they had various people, designers and artists do kind of an interpretation of that. So it's an interesting format to be put on, because you're obviously not trying, you don't want to copy what they did, but you want to be inspired and create your own version of it. And if you see the longer films and you see at the end of the piece you saw, there's the quote from Andy, and throughout the film, the subjects each speak, but it's all in reference then and tied back to a quote from Andy. So, you know, it's my own work with, you know, as portraits, but then there's a tie back to Andy throughout.
Oh, thank you very much. And Pandemonia, I wanted to draw you out a bit more. You spoke just now about how, you know, it's very difficult to become Pandemonia. And Warhol talked a lot about that in Dragon Transformation, where he talked about people having to transform themselves and how, you know, how time consuming it was really for people to transform themselves. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about the commitment to Pandemonia and being you and Pandemonia at the same time, perhaps.
Well, I mean, it does take so long to transform myself as Pandemonia because all the work is done before. I've already made everything before, which that section takes a very long time. But becoming Pandemonia is like kind of, it's like going into a vehicle where it allows me to sort of pass sort of through town and through social situations kind of unnoticed or unseen. So it's a kind of a very interesting experience. Like it's like I'm entering another world. It's like I'm entering into this scene where I'm at the center. I'm also at the outside of it. And although in some respects I'm quite well known, or you know, even famous in some circles, no one knows who I am. So it's like, you know, the Pandemonia is like a film, you know, that's protects me from the outside world. So it's a sort of, there's a lot of things going on.
Yeah, there certainly is, and I think it is incredible how you also the costumes are amazing, all the identities that you have as you are incredible. Mm. And I wanted to ask you, Eric. I mean, there's been record prices for Warhols recently in the sale rooms, and just a question about that really. Warhol is the commodity, you know, the price is being raised, and perhaps talk a little bit about that, because with your hat as, you know, the formerly a director but also working for Sotheby's for an auction house as well.
It's really incredible, and I try to think about it well beyond Warhol, and to certainly think about it philosophically at a very high level of what we value in society. And to think that artists who create individual works of art are valued at that level into now the hundreds of millions of dollars for a single work of art, I think ultimately says that artists win in the end, because we value them and their voice and their radicality really more than anything. Because when one picture rivals the cost of a skyscraper, I think that we can prove that artists emerge victorious.
Gosh, that's a kind of great concluding statement. Artists emerge victorious, a very also very elevating point. But was there, I think we've got a couple more has just come into the question, not a question, but the chat has been disabled. Just a quick note to thank everybody. Ah, okay. Someone's commented that they felt his mum, this is Sumi, was the main driving force behind him. I think that is also a very good point, you know, being able to be, have family support, the mother definitely recognizing his talent and encouraging it. So kind of making it possible, really, making him realize it was possible to achieve. And just in the couple of minutes left, were there any questions the panel would like to ask each other or raise? If you raise your hand and then just say what you'd like to ask. Eric.
Well, I've been a very big fan of Pandemonia from afar for many years, and I always view you, Pandemonia, as the perfect love child between Lee Bowery and Candy Darling. Those are my two reference points for you, but I love that you have created an entity that is able to absorb the gaze and also reflect it back in so many intriguing ways, and you were thus incredibly Warholian thus. But I just wanted to think about or ask you about how you think about the mirror and how you really become a contemporary mirror of society.
Well, I have to say thank you to start with. As a mirror of contemporary society, well, I think it's like looking into yourself, and I sort of reacted to the things that affected me that I seemed to like, and I just sort of follow that. So I don't really follow the latest fashions. I follow the sort of the drives and things that appeal to me. And I just hope it works. And that's the best I think I can do.
It works.
Thank you.
Well, we've got 1 minute left. So I just really want, unless there's any other burning questions, it really remains for me. I've got so many questions I'd like to ask and so many queries really about Warhol. And Chiara, you brought up something I think fascinating about all the things, the archives, the things that, the letters, the time capsules, saving the tape recording, saving every sound, realizing that if you keep everything, if you record everything, somehow people will find importance in them. So, you know, I think that's really important. You're raising your hands there, Pat.
Yes, I have something to say. What I find continually amazing about Warhol is how relevant it still is to today. More so, I think, than any other artist in the 20th century. It's like, is Warhol is the one that seems to talk to us. You know, if you look at Picasso, yeah, some of it's good, but, or you look at, you know, Joseph Beuys, you know, but it's Warhol is the one that is about, is still about now.
Well, Chiara.
Just a tiny point that I think it's beautiful, just following up what Pandemonia said, which is correct, is that in the idea of the 15 minutes of fame and look at Warhol and where he still is today. So I think in that way, it's extraordinary. That this concept then is, you know, is keep extending both in the society we're living in, but that he, his own celebrity and fame has, you know, evolved and grown, if anything, since he passed away.
And I've always felt there was a Warhol for everybody, because he worked, he chose so many different subject matters, and some have not been written about so much, the work he did, the portraits he did of Native Americans, which are incredible, you know, and in fact, the Dragon Transformations and the Ladies and Gentlemen series, which Ladies and Gentlemen particularly, which was shown at the Tate, you know, hadn't really been put together in that way before. So there's many bodies of work that we're exploring and finding messages for contemporary society as well. But it is time to draw it to a close. So I just want to thank everyone so much, to Anita, who's kind of been behind the scenes. Kind of thank you, Anita, for brilliantly organizing everything and answering all the questions and helping with the timings and projections and everything that goes behind the scenes of all these things, and particularly, of course, to fantastic speakers. And thank you for being so generous with your time, and also it always feels it goes too quickly and it raises more questions than answers. But thank you so much for being with us today. And I hope it raises more questions. I think Anita had a couple of things to say about how people can access this afterwards.
Thank you, Jean. That's a very Very lovely conversation and really kind words there. So yes, we'll share the recording with everybody. We've got more links from our fantastic speakers' works that we'll share with all of the attendees as well. But yeah, you can find out more about the rest of our series as well at Ducks for Artists on social and on our website. But yeah, thank you all so much for your really insightful conversation this evening. Thank you, Jean.
Thank you.